Malti, looking lovely.
Thank you. A very special day today, International Girl Child Day.
We are live now, Malti. Malti, we are live.
Okay, start.
Yes.
Good afternoon. I'm Malti Kembavi from Team Population First. A very warm welcome to everyone. 11th October is globally observed as the International Day of Girl Child and aims to acknowledge and challenges the girls face and promote their empowerment. We at Population First have been working consistently to this end. Today, we come together once again to mark this special day and to renew our efforts to ensure that girls have a better tomorrow as well as today. The theme this year is Digital Generation, Our Generation, and taking inspiration from this, our event seeks to understand just how different is this generation as well as how vulnerable. So without any further delay, let me invite Dr. A.L. Sharda, Director Population First, to share her thoughts and formally welcome our guests of honor, panelists, and viewers. Over to you, Dr. Sharda.
Thank you, Malti. Good afternoon, everybody. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome you all to today's event, marking the International Day of the Girl Child. I still remember vividly the first event we organized in 2011 when IDGC was declared. We were happy then that at last there is acknowledgement that the girl child faces many challenges and much discrimination, and there is a need to address the same. In these 10 years, we have seen some positive changes in the indices, be it school and enrollment, retention, decrease in child marriages, nutrition's improvement in the nutrition status of girls, etc. But there is a lot that still needs to be done to provide a level playing field for the girls. Unfortunately, the pandemic has undone some of the progress we made and accentuated the gender gaps. The excessive reliance on digital means to survive in the pandemic times has brought the gender divide into glaring focus. Not just that, but also how digital world is promoting online harassment, abuse, violence. We are still trying to put in place systems to address these new threats. Obviously, the girl child is the most vulnerable in this context, with studies showing that sexually explicit content has increased manifold during online sexually abusive content has increased manifold during the pandemic. It is thus apt that this year's theme is declared as Digital World and Our World, Our World. Today we have with us three different conversations. Today we have three different conversations happening involving adults and children who are using the digital apps and media in innovative and creative ways to bring about change. Identity, Nimble Q, Vannat Shala, the three initiatives that are being showcased today. I welcome all of them and the three facilitators of the conversations Gargi, Ritu, Alka, Dhukar. As you all know, largely media initiatives are supported by the UNFPA and the Royal Norwegian Embassy. We are honored to have with us Mr. Haridass from UNFPA and Ms. Strand from the Royal Norwegian Embassy joining us today. A warm welcome to you too. How can we have an IDGC event without some fun? So here we have with us the Kadanika team presenting to us an interesting and thought-provoking puppet show. It's ages. You know, we are talking about digital issues using the most ancient art form, that is puppetry. And that's the irony or what, that is the beauty of today's event. And the play shows us what to do. Play shows the children what to do and what not to do on internet. So I hope all of us will enjoy this evening. And we rededicate ourselves to make this world, in whatever way we can, however small the difference we can make, a better place for the girl child. Remember, it is her right. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sharda. Thank you so much for your words. Let's now watch the Ladli song by Sunita Rao. Boli si aankhon mein sapne hai sajaya. Wow, what a touching song is that with children. Let me just translate this in English. It says, let us ensure that our ladlis are empowered to dream big and fulfill their dreams. Today, we are privileged to have amongst us Mr. Sriram Haridass, representative acting in charge UNFPA, as our guest honor. Mr. Haridass, a national of Sri Lanka, brings with him over 18 years experience in strategic planning, programming in both development and humanitarian context. Prior to joining UNFPA India, he served in UNFPA Sierra Leone, where in addition to overseeing the implementation of large-scale donor-funded projects, he also coordinated the UNFPA's response to the Ebola crisis. Before that, Mr. Haridass spent nearly 9 years with UNHCR in Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, and South Sudan. We invite him to say a few words. Over to you, Mr. Haridass.
Thanks, Malati. I hope I am clear and
yes,
audible. Yeah, great. Thanks, Malati. I'm really excited to be part of this digital event, which provides an opportunity to hear directly from young people and change makers. And of course, looking forward to the puppet show as well. Good afternoon, everyone. The International Day of the Girl Child is observed each year to focus attention towards empowering girls and amplifying their voice. The day is an opportunity to draw attention to the diverse needs of girls and address challenges faced by them, so that they can achieve their full potential and lead a life of dignity and well-being. The theme for the 2021 International Day of the Girl Child is Digital Generation. So today, as we mark this special day, which was in fact was yesterday, we are celebrating girls in the digital era. Girls are harnessing the power of new technologies to carve out a better future for all. This is very timely as the pandemic and the measures adopted to control the spread of the COVID-19, be it lockdown or social distancing, have had a wide impact and have accelerated the use of digital platforms for learning and schooling, earning, entertaining, shopping, and connecting. Digital platforms provided solutions to many problems, and technology yet again proved to be a useful tool during this crisis as well. As we celebrate girls in the digital generation, we must also call urgent attention to those left behind by gender discrimination that systematically limit girls now and across their lifetime. these inequalities unfortunately extend to the internet as well, which as all of you know, girls still use less than boys, up to 4 times less in some countries. Even in India, the National Family Health Survey 5, which for the first time gathered data on the use of internet, shows that only 42% of Indian women use the internet compared to 62% of men. The figure is far worse if you look at only rural areas. As you know, the data is currently available only for 22 states. I wouldn't be surprised if the numbers go further down when the data becomes available for the whole country. So this kind of digital divide actually compounds longstanding gender disparities and cuts across gender and other intersectionalities in terms of owning devices, connectivity, usage, and skills. The digital gap, which is a result of complex set of social, economic, and cultural barriers, prevents girls from accessing education, participating in economic activities, accessing information and services, enjoying the benefits of scientific progress, and achieving their full potential, of course. While inequalities have always existed, like Sharda mentioned in her opening remarks, the COVID-19 pandemic has shown how quickly inequalities can multiply. Under school closures, girls who lack internet access have seen losses in education, health, information, and other services. In many places, including in India, girls denied an education face an increased risk of being married off against their will. Why actually go that far? Take the example of COVID-19 vaccines. If an 18 or 19-year-old girl doesn't have access to internet, she will not have access to vaccines. As simple as that. So whether we like it or not, it's now becoming clear that the realization of many rights is increasingly based on digital access, which can help girls find information, connect with peers, build social movement, explore their identities, and find help for, say, harassment or violence online, or even genderic harassment. It is also clear that without access to technology, girls will face major barriers in achieving their sexual and reproductive health and bodily autonomy. The shame or embarrassment girls may feel in asking questions about sex or gender identity in many societies, including in India, is more readily overcome in the anonymity of the online world. Considering that the fact that the technology can be a great enabler for women and girls, we need to address this exclusion gap. We can do this by, say, advocating for tangible benefits this would have for girls, invest in education and capacity building initiative that increase girls' digital skills and confidence, creating user-friendly digital tools and online content for girls, involving more women in design, development, production, and governance of digital technologies. Having said all this, we also need to be aware of the downsides and negative impacts of digital platforms, which are beginning to become increasingly visible. Say, for example, girls with access to these technologies face mounting risks from various forms of cyber violence, including online bullying, trolling, stalking, online sexual harassment, violation of personal privacy. There are many more. A growing sense of disconnect and isolation leading to mental health issues and high levels of stress among young people. Social media, computer games, some of these dating websites, we know that they can be very addictive. And we also know that access for girls with disabilities remains insufficient in the digital world. And local language availability, content in the local language, is far too limited. These issues, unfortunately, they too reflect harmful gender power imbalances, I would say. But as our executive director, Dr. Natalia Kanam, says, we must not tolerate a digital world that reinforces inequality. Instead, we should use these tools to close the gender power gap for girls. And we are already trying to do this through several of our projects. This is what happened when a 14-year-old young girl in Rajasthan, her name is Ragini, used the information provided by the UNFPA supported mobile edutainment services, the project is called Nawad Baja, to save a friend from child marriage. We have many such similar success stories, and today we will hear from young girls and changemakers on how they have tried to close the gender power gap using digital tools. But girls aren't just using these tools. In many places, they are creating them, and we need to support them. From our side, we are committed to team up with different partners to provide the mentorship and resources girls need to design innovative digital solutions for a more equal future. And let me take a minute here to acknowledge the support provided by one such partner, the Norwegian Embassy in Delhi, whose support, among other things, has also made it possible for us to organize this webinar today. So Marit, Thank you for the Norwegian government's continued support and investment in creating a more equal future for girls. As we celebrate the International Day of the Girl Child, I look forward to listening to voices of empowerment from the digital world and from the young girls who are present here. Let us learn from these young girls as to how they are using digital tools to create a world that is accessible and safe for all. I strongly believe that together we can create a digital world and build a future in which every girl is able to realize her full potential and power. Thanks. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. Haridass, for your encouraging words. Thank you so much. Moving on to the next, I now present our first conversation with Indu Harikumar, who's an artist, writer, and an internet user of over two decades. She uses Instagram to create a space for conversations and experience sharing on gender and sexuality through people-powered art projects on social media. Amongst these, for example, are hashtag notes to my lovers and hashtag identity. Engaging her would be Gargi Ranade, a young budding psychologist and an avid internet user. Over to you, Gargi and Indu.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so to begin with, can you tell us a little bit about how it was to be on the internet 25 years ago? Because I wasn't here 25 years ago.
Hi everyone. I got on the internet when I was 16, and I don't know if I was 15 or 16, but I got on the internet in 95, and I think our family was the 19th family in Bombay, or I don't know, to get a TCP IP account. So, you know, at that point, you also had something called a shell account, which was just text, internet with just text. But the TCP IP account was something with images and text. And it wasn't like you just reach for your phone. You had to use a modem. You had to use your phone line. You had to connect, and it didn't connect half the time. It was slow, but it was fascinating. I think when I was 16, I got onto chat rooms. There were no pictures because there were no digital cameras at that point. And there were, at some point, webcams came in, but I can't quite say when because it just seems so long ago. But it was a fascinating world where you could, I lived almost in the outskirts of the city, but I could connect with different people around the world. And I really feel that at that point, you could actually buy a house with that kind of money. But I'm glad my father invested in the internet because it really changed my life.
Right. And so how old were you when social media became a thing, and what was it like? Because when I was 15, Facebook was just coming into the picture and Orkut was already dying. And I think kids right now don't even know what Orkut is. So what was your journey on social media like?
I would say that I'll tell you about this article that I read in 2000, and I think it was 2003 or 4. It was on the New York Times, and it basically talked about how there was going to be something like this where you could actually find out where your friends had been, and there would be pictures, and you could like, and you could actually have geotagging, which for me, I remember reading it and thinking, oh my God, that sounds scary. But now, the amount of information that we share on the internet, I mean, there's been such a drastic change in over the years, I feel. I know that I had a digital camera when I was 20, which was in 2000, but I didn't put pictures online. My whole name was never online. Those things have changed over time because, you know, I think we are also social beings. We see other people doing it, and then it becomes all right and like a normative thing to do. Even I think I was on Twitter in 2007, but I was a quiet person. I was a lurker, looking at what other people were saying, but never opening my mouth too much. RTing from time to time, but not saying much because I was always scared of judgment or what people would think of me. Yeah.
Has that
when
changed?
Did, I mean, if I could ask, sorry, if I yeah. could ask you something, yes. when did you get on social media? And how old were you?
I got on social media when I was 16. So that was in 2013. That was just Facebook and Twitter. Instagram was not as popular as it is now. And that was mainly, I mean, I was very vocal on social media. I know that. And so were my friends. I was there when Facebook became popular and when Twitter was still a very, very niche thing. And it was not like, so right now, Facebook isn't popular with 16-year-olds at all. And Twitter is only meant for the edgy, intellectual niche people. And Instagram is the most popular platform right now, which was not the case when I joined in. And I was definitely not a lurker. I was pretty much putting all of my opinions out there.
Also, I remember there was Snapchat, and I used to really, shame myself, saying that, "Hey, you've been on the internet for so long. How is it you don't understand this?" But I could just never understand Snapchat. Did you ever use Snapchat?
I used Snapchat for about 2 months, and that's when they introduced streaks, which like you have to send pictures to the other person at least once in 24 hours. And if either of you, I mean, so if you go on for longer than like 4 or 5 days, then you get a fire icon next to this person's name. And so this one time I missed sending it to a friend and they called me and told me to send them a photo just because, you know, otherwise the streak would break. And that's when I decided this is not for me. This is not that important in my life. But yeah, so Snapchat is even now, it's not a... I think it's still only exclusively used by teenagers. I never got into Snapchat. I don't even consider it as a social media. But anyway, all right. So I'm going to share one of your comics on screen right now. 1 second. Can you see this? Okay, so I'm just going to read it out for people who can't read if the text is too small. It says that this year I decided to work on my graphic novel every day. When I was about to forget about it, a big publisher told me they had read about my book and they were interested. So I started. Every time I couldn't deal with my self-doubt, I'd come online to drown in my inadequacy. This getting online was not helping me concentrate, plus people were doing way more than me. Self-doubt plus jealousy plus uncertainty was killing me. So I allocated research time every day, made a comic, and stayed offline. It meant I had to sit with my discomfort of not being any good and let it pass and work. Then the second wave happened. My financial situation remained unchanged, was deep in work. The news was heartbreaking. And as a person who does fundraising through the year, I felt I should do something, but I didn't want to engage, didn't want to take on secondary trauma. So I shut down the news and went to work. I sat with the discomfort of being selfish and bad person, a person who was trying to write a book when the world was ending. I kept my despair and anger offline, mostly because I didn't want to engage with others over it and multiply it. I sat with my discomfort and let it pass. It was a strange time to learn to protect and nurture oneself. I grew up hearing, be good and helpful whenever you can. Now I remind myself, I can't be good and helpful while not being good and helpful to myself. So what I wanted to ask you was, does the internet ever make you feel overwhelmed, or how does it sort of affect your mental health overall? Because most of your work happens on the internet, so you can't avoid it. But where do you draw the line?
Yes, I mean, a lot of my work is possible because of the internet. Even before Instagram, I've used, I've written books for children. And at one point I remember I used to work with a nonprofit and I would tweet about the class. I didn't think anyone was reading it. But at that point, Pratham Books picked it up and, you know, it meant work for me. So the internet has always brought me work. It has like brought me work from places that I couldn't ever dream of. And, you know, I feel that it's also helped me get a work because, all places aren't accessible to everyone, but the internet in many ways was, helped me bridge those. I could write to people and people could see my work online and would get back to me. But this, especially in the pandemic, I felt like, and my work is also extremely personal where I listen to other people's stories and I have to be present, which means that it's a lot of secondary trauma. And, it also helps me have a vocabulary, but after a point, it's draining. So I had to, and I realized that I used to reach for my phone every 2 minutes because it was so easy. You know, it's so easy. Okay, you're bored, or this is a difficult thing to do, or you don't want to sit with a difficult emotion, you immediately reach for your phone. So one of the things that I did with starting June, July was that I cut off all my notifications, which I didn't have earlier too. Then I told my friends I was going off WhatsApp. I would only check it thrice. I also told, I logged out of Instagram. It was really difficult initially, but if you don't have, and I also put off the internet on my phone, which meant that I still reached for my phone, but there was nothing on it because there was no internet. And that really helped me regulate how much of the internet I was consuming. And I also now make sure that I'm not consuming, news in the in the night, because it really, even if I go to sleep, my mind is constantly working with that news on. So I'm careful about what I'm consuming in the night. I don't have to share everything that I do. Like earlier, all my friends would live share what is happening. Oh, I went there, this thing happened. Hey, take a look at the picture. Okay, we ate this. Now I realize that I don't want to do this because as soon as I stop doing it, I know that my friends also have to stop doing it. And it means that way lesser information about each other. And it, I think, also helps us in keeping our relationships going. What about you? What do you do? How do you keep yourself sane on the internet? Does it overwhelm you?
It does, especially with the news. But it does overwhelm me because I realized that I was getting 90% of my news on Instagram, which is not where you should be getting your news. So I limited like how many news related accounts I was following, and I stopped doing that. So it helped to compartmentalize what app I was getting my news from. So as soon as I stopped going to Instagram for what was happening around the world, it became a slightly better place in terms of I knew that if I go on there, I'm not going to be bombarded with opinion pieces or traumatic news from all over. And I could, it gave me agency to choose when and how I was going to find out what was happening. And there is always something happening. So you can't, I don't want to live in the dark, but I do want to be able to go about my life with some sort of hope rather than just constantly being told that this is a hopeless world. So that helped. And turning off notifications is easily the best thing I have done with my phone in the longest time. So yeah, that's how I coped. But does it ever make you feel like you aren't doing enough, or you're not, or that other people are doing too much and you can't possibly match up? And does that make you feel any difficult emotions?
I would say that even without the internet or without social media, I felt that I wasn't doing enough. But with social media, I think it gets amplified because you only see a part of people's lives. You don't see the struggle. You only see that, hey, they won this. Okay, they are having fun now. But you don't know about so many other things about people's lives. So it's very easily, you can very easily, I feel jealous from time to time and I feel like what I'm doing is not enough. I will be happy if I have, their life. Maybe now, like what they are having now. I find myself there very often. But I feel reducing how much of the internet I consume has definitely made a huge difference. Because I know when I fell in love with the internet, it was not 24/7. It was not personal and on a phone. You had to actually go sit near a computer and connect, and it took forever. So it was something special. But now that it's on my phone, it is something that is also has a drastic effect on my mental health, depending on what I consume, what I'm thinking about at that point. And I think it also, sometimes I'm unable to even connect with myself because I'm so consumed with what I should be.
So do you think the questions we should be having with our kids before they go onto the internet, that this thing, yes, but it can also make you feel certain things that may not be comfortable with, but can definitely be dealt with as you use it?
Gargi, I'm sorry, I don't know if it's my internet, but I couldn't hear what you were just saying.
Okay, is it better now? Because yeah. No, I was asking, do you think we should be having these conversations with our children about how the internet is definitely a good place, but it can also make you feel emotions that are not comfortable, that you're not used to, and that you may not know how to cope with? So is this a thing that, is this one of the talks that we should be having with our children before they go on the internet?
One, I would like to start with this, that in the initial years, everything that happened on the internet was not even considered real. That was not real life. If you had a friend online, that was not real. So, for me, the pandemic was a time that people were actually, using the internet so much. These difficult emotions aren't something that you will not face in real life. In your offline life, these are something, but some things that you see online may trigger it. And I won't even say that the internet is like a safe space. It's not. The world is not always safe, There are all sorts of people and all sorts of emotions, all sorts of things that happen. I've lost that train of thought.
No, so essentially I'm saying that as the internet becomes more and more popular, how to be on the internet and internet etiquette and what is acceptable and what is not acceptable is obviously something that we will need to speak to our children about. But also, 100% of the responsibility can't be on the kids of making the internet a safe space.
I don't think the onus should be on children at all, whether to make the world a safe space or the internet a better space. The onus should be on adults, on parents, on social media companies, to make the internet safe for the child. The onus should not lie on the child. And there should be spaces for most children to also address some of these issues that come up when they are on the internet.
Right. Yeah.
Are you done with your questions?
So, yeah. Can I just share one last comic? Or do we have time?
Sure, please go ahead.
Right. So this says that I don't have to outsmart or outdo anyone to have worth. An education abroad, trips abroad, a lot of money, a great job, a good home have nothing to do with my worth. Relationships are not an indicator of my worth. Oh yeah, and the number of likes on this post aren't an indicator. Because I exist, I have nothing to prove to the world.
Thank you.
Okay, that's it from us.
Thank you. Thank you so much. What a wealth of experience and sharing. Thank you, Indu and Gargi. Thank you so much. Moving on to the next. We are honored to have Ms. Marit Strand, Counsellor and Head of Cooperation at the Norwegian Embassy in New Delhi, as our second guest of honor. Ms. Strand has more than 20 years' experience in development work and has previously been posted to Nepal and Mozambique. Ms. Strand is an economist by training from Oslo University. A very warm welcome, ma'am. May we please invite you to say a few words.
Thank you, Malati, and thank you for this these very interesting discussions and comments. And I'm very happy that I was invited to participate in today's event. A special greeting to Dr. Sharada and to UNFF and UNFPA representative Sriram Haridass, and to our fellow speakers and our audience as well. I just wanted to share a personal observation first, and that is that I, even at my age, because I'm a little bit older, and also I come from a different place and have a different background, but I was recognizing quite a bit in the last conversation, and I thought that was a very interesting way to angle this discussion, and I see how important it is to raise these issues. I myself am often more careful in social media than I would be in a real-life meeting when I was talking to somebody, and I take care to not post things that I think might be provoking to some people and so forth. So I see how these issues are affecting us all, really. And it's very important to talk about them. And of course, Norway is a long-term partner with UNFPA and other UN organizations. And we are very happy and proud to support UNFPA's global program and also their country program here in India, where we have been in particular working on the preference for son issues and also child marriage. I think it's also fitting to mention that while this is areas of work where Norway has been engaged for some time, 2 years ago, we launched on the International Day of the Girl Child, a new strategy against harmful practices to give ourselves a more focused approach. And that is what we are implementing along the lines of here. I would also like to underline the importance of our close cooperation with many NGOs and how important their work obviously is at the practical level, and that is how we actually implement so many things. I would just like to also reiterate very briefly the comments that while these issues are important all the time, they are particularly important now, given the negative impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic that has had effects upon us all, but particularly upon women and girls. And this particular risk that the digital divide for some groups might actually increase, which is why the Norwegian strategies against harmful practices and as well as our digital strategy is so much focused upon reaching the most vulnerable groups and reaching the groups that are the hardest to reach. And I think that this is very important to keep in mind. While we use digital tools for many positive things, I would like to mention in particular the work that Norway does within digital education and using digital tools to reach children that for various reasons that could be conflict or some other form of crisis are taken out of their regular schooling, and then they can use digital tools, not only in the COVID. And at the same time, we have to remember all these other aspects of the digital divide. So I think that this was a very good reminder to us. Moving forward, we've had very good discussions, I feel, on the differences and barriers, and just to also remind that even if all these digital issues were removed, that wouldn't necessarily remove all the social issues and local context issues that can make it more difficult for girls to access the digital arena on the same level as boys, and also perhaps not be as safe there as they should be. So we appreciate today's topic very much. Just wanted to mention that yesterday on the marking of the celebration in Norway, our Minister for Development, Mr. Dag Inge Ulstein, gave his chair as development minister to a young girl, Kala, who then was the development minister for the day. And I think that these types of interventions are also good to have. I'm looking forward to the rest of our program and feel that this is important to continue working on and that these issues don't stand alone, that they have to stand in a larger context. So thank you for this. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Strand. Thank you. Moving on to our next. As we all know, child marriage is still a major problem in many parts of the country, which denies girls their right to development, protection, and participation. We present to you a movie by students of TIS, which was an award winner of our 1 minute movie contest, which is Young Mothers. Please watch it. What a touching video. I must mention that since the video was created, fresh set of data was released following the NFHS 4 in 2016. It shows that the rate has declined to 27% from 47%. Good news, but we still have a long way to go to make a better world for our girls. Moving on to the next, we now present a panel of young students of NimbleQ, an organization that nurtures young minds aged 5 years through 14 years to challenge assumptions, innovate, and address problems. It gets them future ready by imparting technological, business, and entrepreneurship skills, as well as financial literacy. We present to you Archita and Garvit, students of grade 6, and she, a fourth grade student, who have either crafted or in the process of developing apps for business, social media campaigns, and educational needs. In conversation with them is Ritu Motyal, consultant communications for Population First. Over to you, Ritu and team.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to this conversation, which I'm very excited to have. So I have with me students of Nimble Q, as Malti said. So I'm going to first call upon, in an alphabetical order, I'm going to talk to Archita. Archita, could you please unmute yourself?
Ma'am, am I audible?
Yes, you are. Thank you. Archita, I believe you're working on some exciting project using technology, and you've kind of developed sort of an app, or you're in the process of developing. Could you just take us through all of it? And also, before you take us through it, I'd like to understand from you, how has technology helped you in, you know, in thinking through problems, in making your life a little easier? Could you share that with us, please?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, technology has changed our quality of life. Like, it saves our time and it saves our lives better, and it entertains us, and it helps us getting lots of information and knowledge.
Great. So could you also tell us about the business idea that you're working on, and how are you developing the app, and also show us whatever little you've developed?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you.
I have thought of an app. It is an educational assistance app for visually and hearing impaired people. I've named it as Drishti and Dhwani app. Visually and hearing impaired people can read books which are printed in braille script, and hearing impaired people can read books, but explaining those books to them is difficult, for which sign language is used. So I've made an app. It works on mobile data and artificial intelligence, and it works with the help of three devices: a mobile or laptop with the Drishti and Dhwani app, a scanner, and a printer specially designed to print braille script. If any deaf person wants to understand any book, he needs to scan the page by putting it on scanner. Then the app will ask that person whether he wants to see the book in visual form. On getting instruction, the app will convert the scanned text to visuals. Then on mobile or laptop screen, an animated character will explain the book in sign language. And if any blind person wants to read or listen in a book, he needs to scan the page by putting it on scanner. Then the app will ask that person whether he wants to listen to the book, or he wants to wants the printout of the book in braille script. On getting printing instruction, the app will convert the scanned text to braille format and print its and give its print in braille script. And on getting speech instruction, the app will convert the scanned text to a speech format and recite the page in any of the language of user's choice. The beneficiaries of this app are deaf and blind people, the teachers or government or school and private school, any place where blind and deaf people work.
Yes, please carry on.
I would just like to share my screen and show you the app.
Yes, and you're in standard 6. Have I got that right?
Yes.
Okay, great. Can you share your screen now, please?
Yes, ma'am. Are you able to see now?
Yes.
So in this app, as you can see, there are three options: Hindi, English, and Urdu. Like, if I click on English and then I write hi.
Hi.
Ma'am, are you able to hear?
Yes.
And in Hindi.
Namaste. Salam.
Ma'am, for this speech, I've used this play speech block. And I've, like, if I change this to female, sorry, male.
Hi.
Ma'am, I'm still working on this app, but in future when I grow up, I definitely make an app which will be useful for blind people also, to get print in their script, and for deaf people also.
Right. Archita, can you speak without your, can you speak a little louder, because your voice is very feeble, people cannot hear you.
Can you hear me now?
A slightly little louder, probably.
Now?
Yes.
So ma'am, I'm saying that I'm working on this app, but in future, I'll definitely make something which will be helpful to deaf people also, and which will convert the scanned text to braille script also.
Okay, thank you, Archita. I believe you have an exam today, so all the best for your exam. Yeah, anything else that you'd like to share with us about technology, or that's it, and then we can go on to Garvit.
Auntie, that's it.
Thank you. So, can I now request Garvit to join us?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, Garvit, how are you? Can you have your video on, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Garvit, how are you doing? Okay, your video is going off. Right. So, Garvit, what are you going to be discussing with us? Garvit, your voice is wobbly. Can you speak into the?
Ma'am, I am going to tell about the app which I made for my mother.
Oh, great. So what does your mother do?
Ma'am, my mother is a freelancer makeup artist.
Okay. And what was the app that you developed for her?
Ma'am, so that she could send her photos at one go.
Okay, great. So can you share it? And can you also tell us how has it affected your mother's business? What has the feedback been?
I'll just, ma'am, share my screen. Ma'am, can we share it from mobile?
Yes, you should have the opportunity to share. I mean,
we can share it from our phone.
Yes, you should be able to just share the screen.
Ma'am, yeah, this is Garvit Singh's mother. Hello.
Yes, hi.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, Garvit just arrived from school. He just arrived from school and he is opening his laptop and, you know, he's just getting prepared. So, okay. Ma'am, can you take the next student and after that, Garvit will be prepared with the...
Sure. So, I'll just speak to Sheel till then. Hi, Sheel.
Yeah.
Hello.
How are you doing? Can you have your camera on, please?
Yes, I'm just there.
Right, Sheel. So, Sheel, you are a standard fourth child, right?
Yes.
Okay. And your app talks about, would you like to briefly explain to us?
Yes, I would like to briefly explain about my business idea.
Right.
Okay. So, I have a business idea. I participated in the business idea hackathon on NimbleCube. Yes. So, what I did was, I had an idea to how to make parks safer during the coronavirus times.
Right.
So, it'll help you maintain distance with people. It'll help you book, book appointments with people. So, like, there'll be an app, and you will say, okay, I want a booking from 2:30 to 3:30 on Monday. So it will automatically give you a QR code, which when you go there, you will scan and they'll say, okay, yeah, it's you, you can go. So you go inside and you basically say, now you basically start playing like normal. And then you say, okay, I have to sanitize my hands halfway through. So you go and sanitize your hands. Then if you get too close to a person, there'll be an alarm saying, okay, you're way too close. And then it'll just be like, okay, please maintain your distance. So you maintain distance and your 1 hour is over.
Okay.
Then when you go outside, and as soon as you step out of the park, your QR code expires. The whole playground is sanitized again, and because a business cannot just go on for 2-3 years. It should go on for at least 10-20 years. I'm going to think after the COVID times that this app should become a play date app.
Oh, nice. So you've thought of a continuity plan as well.
Yes.
So before I ask you to share, I know that you're working on this app and it's still in the process of development, but you're going to be sharing something else with us. I want to ask you a quick question. Since you've been using internet and you've been using technology, so would you from your point of view sort of share with us what are the, you know, how do you make sure that it is safe for you? What are the precautions that you take? So how do you handle all of that?
Yeah. So when you talk about what like precautions and how you will take a few precautions to be like careful, one thing that might happen is that you have some danger to getting viruses in your laptop. So there's one quick thing that you should do that will totally make sure that you're on a safe website. All you have to do is go to the URL that you're looking for, and there'll be like a lock sign over there. Right. If the lock sign is showing, that means you're totally secure. And if it's showing like an unlock sign, or if it's showing like an exclamation mark, that means you're not secure. So you shouldn't go on that website.
Okay, great. Anything else, or that's about it? And then you can show us your app.
Okay.
So what is the app? Can you quickly explain? I know it's not the business idea. You've got the business idea separate and an app separate.
Yes.
Yeah.
Maybe I can share my screen and show you really quickly.
Okay.
So I'll share my screen. Just give me a minute. Here. So over here, I have an Apple Grab game. Okay. So in this, I have my score. And if you can see, there's a really tiny bitten apple over here.
Yes.
So I need to just click on the apple and it'll keep on moving. Now, as you can hear, maybe you can hear a sound. Can you hear the sound?
Yes.
Okay. So now let me show you how simple and easy it is to change. So I've written 46 lines of code in this app. Let me show you how I'll change my sound. So all I go over here is I go to the sound area. I just click that. Just gonna do that. One second, sorry. I just go here. One second. So actually, I don't think this is working. What I'll do is over here, I'll go right here and I'll have an option of choosing sound. And I'll just go over. There and quickly click the sound. And then I'll just click the sound that I want, and then it'll just change. So let me try it once more. Sorry.
It's okay, Sheil. I think we get an idea.
And I don't think it's happening right now.
No, that's okay. The internet's been a bit.
Yeah, I'll just stop.
Okay, great. But thank you so much for sharing that. And, yeah.
You're welcome.
Are you able to unshare the screen?
Sorry, can you?
Okay, I'm going to request our host to, yeah, that's fine. So,
I don't think I'm being able to.
That's okay.
My screen's totally frozen.
Yeah, that's okay. Thank you very much, Sheel. I'm going to turn to Garvit. I see he was online. And let him share his app with us. So is Garvit there? Garvit, are you ready?
Yes, you can ask the host to stop my screen sharing. That's possible.
She's already done that.
Ma'am, I'm ready. The start.
Okay. I can't.
Right. So, Garvit, can you share your screen and show us your app, what you've developed for your mother?
Yes. One second.
Okay, let me try this. I can't do it right now for some reason. Really won't do anything.
Yeah. Right, Garvit, can you share your screen with us and share what...
Ma'am, I shared it.
No, I'm not able to see it.
I'm going to try again.
Okay.
One second.
Yes.
Now can you see, ma'am?
Yes, yes.
So, ma'am, this app I made for my mother. She was asking me if she can send pictures in one go. So she asked me to make an app so that she can send her photos.
Right.
Then I said, yes, mama, I can make it for you. So, ma'am, it like helps the clients to see all things, all the photos, all the descriptions and all those things, ma'am.
Okay, can you show it to us? How does it work?
Yes. There is a next button. We just have to click it and it will just... So it will just, ma'am, take you to the next screen. Now, I think this is the wrong one.
That's okay. Carry on. We'll.
Ma'am, I made this. So this is, ma'am, all the description is there, where my mother lives and how she travels and all her number. Right. So. When we, ma'am, it is there's an so you can, ma'am, like scroll, move to the next photo. There is all the details in this,
right? So from what I understand, the problem was that she wanted to share her work with more clients and get more clients,
yes,
right? Great. And this is how you've come up with and used the knowledge that you gained at your classes about technology. Very nice, Garvit. And what has the feedback been from your mother's clients and other people?
Ma'am, they said it is very good. And the number that you gave me in the description, ma'am, because there's my also mother's number. So they are saying it is very good. My like a cousin or something, I can send your number to them. It is very easy to see also.
And has it helped your mother's business? Did you see the numbers growing up and all?
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, great. Thank you, Garvit. Thank you so much. And I think it's a great job. People have been commenting on this chat. What a great thing you kids have done. So thank you so much for sharing this with us.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so we're on to the next one. Malti, over to you.
Thank you. Wow, what an impressive. Thank you, Ritu. That was really impressive. Congrats, Archita, Garvit, and Sheel. Fantastic work. Our young generation. Thank you so much. Our young generation is indeed inspiring all of us to work with what they are doing. They're very innovative. I'm sure we're going to see very good days ahead. Moving on to the next, we now
present to you a unique initiative, Bannat Shala, a web-based radio project run by the children for the children, created by Bipin Chandra Chaugle and Dr. Vedavati Jogi. It means a wonderful school and is broadcast in Marathi and Hindi every week. The program seeks to discuss a wide range of topics, imparting information, guidance, and counseling while encouraging a healthy exchange of ideas. Talking to them is Alka Dupar, a well-known journalist and also a popular podcaster currently working with the Times Internet Limited as an assistant editor reporting. Alka, over to you with the Bannat Shala team.
Yes, thank you, Malti. And welcome Dr. Vedavati and Professor Bipin Chandra Chaugule. I welcome you both, and we are looking forward to the discussion we are going to have. I have two guests and a restricted time, so let's get to the topic. I was watching one of the videos made by Bannat Shala, and the catchline was "Aurat ke baare mein soch badalni hai, to catch them young." And exactly what these two former officials of Bal Chitravani. They are based in Pune, and that is what they are doing. We are talking about violence, abuse, and whatnot. But they are trying to curb it. They are trying to stop it because they believe in prevention. Professor Chaugule, I'll start with you. We know that one of the great businessmen, Cyrus Poonawalla, helped you to start this initiative. But can you take us back to 2019 when you came up with this idea with Dr. Jogi, and what was the thought process behind this project? Professor Chaugule?
Has he joined? Is he visible there?
If, okay, no problem. Dr. Jogi, you can go ahead with the question.
Yeah, we had an alternative. He is in hospital.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We have read in newspaper that type 2-3 years back, Dr. Cyrus Poonawalla is helping rape victims. So we felt that prevention is always better than cure, isn't it? So yes. We had this idea of Bannat Shala, ki we will try to change the but child's attitude towards woman, boy's attitude towards girl, and girl's attitude towards herself. Because they always have carry very low self-esteem, girls also. And yes. Many times rape victim feels she is the culprit. Actually, culprit doesn't have any shame. He's shamelessly he's roaming around. So we felt that we have to change the attitude towards woman. And there are many, many crimes against women. She is not even allowed to take birth. So like that. So this was the origin actually. We approached him with this idea. And he liked the idea. He sanctioned money and thus Bannat Shala started.
Yes. And you did all the research, which I'll come to you. I guess we have now Professor Chaugule with us. Chaugule sir, can you hear me?
I think Bipin is having an issue with his mic.
He is having some problem.
Okay, okay, no problem. I got the message that he has joined the discussion. So, Dr. Jogi, tell us about the research you have done for this project. Because now you have expanded your target audience. I mean, the students more than thousands. It is you have associated with different community radios and government initiatives too. So it is not only two individuals who are trying to do something for gender equality. It has expanded and grown out the project. So could you tell us about your research and how it helped to grow this project?
Sure. Actually, as we know, in NCC or in Girl Guide, they teach you certain skills like tying knots of strings in disciplined manner to pull something or to save lives. If you remember, in 1976-77, four educated boys from Pune who were in their 20s, they used same knots to strangulate people just for the sake of few thousands. Do you remember Joshi Habyankar Hatyakand? So that time I was a schoolgirl that time. Since then, I've been thinking that teaching skills is not enough. Okay, it has to be coupled with cultural betterment, right?
Yes.
Because otherwise, same skills can be used for destructive purpose. So in 2011, I got senior fellowship of Culture Ministry Government of India to carry out research on this subject, cultural betterment and creative development through self-expression. And I carried out my research in government observation homes in Pune. And oh my God, when I gave them activities to express themselves, it was like opening Pandora's box. Lot of things came out, like there's anger, hatred towards this life and this world, and helplessness, lot of commotion. So initially those boys were saying, yes, I have committed a sin, I have committed murder, and yes, whatever I have done was right. Gradually what happened, when they started speaking, when I allowed them to express themselves, gradually thinking process was channelized. When they started thinking, that led to introspection. And I think introspection was the turning point in child's life. So that was my research. Okay.
Okay.
And I felt we have to give them some good medium to express themselves. Radio was the obvious choice because less cost, then easy to use. Their identity will not be disclosed. So all these points were there. So that's why Bannat Shala, like web radio.
Yes. Yes. So, Doctor, you were telling about children in observation center. I understand that more than 50 observation centers across Maharashtra you have already covered, and children there between the age group of 12 to 19, they are waiting for this, yes, weekly web-based radio program, web-based, which is free of cost. You have not stopped to observation centers. You have got in association with the government.
Community radios.
So can you tell us about it? How are the children, the target audience, if we have to say in our language, how are they receiving your efforts? What is their responses?
Well, responses are many. I will mention only two, which will give you idea about the whole thing. In our 30 minutes program, there is one segment called Radio Time Pass. So this is the way they speak. Yeah, hey, radio time pass. And main kon hu? Kon hu main? I am radio jockey so and so. Like, and they enjoy it a lot. And that radio time pass is meant for their self-expression. So in that, see, first program, we talked about important female relations in their lives. Sister,
like,
and mother.
Sister, correct.
Boy who had committed even murder, he too broke down. He remembered his mother, remembered his sister, how my mother used to work so hard whole day, how my drunkard father used to beat my mother, how my sister saved me from my father, so many things. And then he was repenting for not listening to his mother. Then he said, when I'm released from this place, when I will go back to my mother and sister, I will look after them. Mera jo bhi kuch hoga, everything will be for them. So this was a turning point. Again, I said, no?
Yes.
What's the first example I'll give? Second example, one girl from Zurich who was forced to leave her education in 9th standard, get married. Even she gave birth to a baby boy, but she was very ambitious. She resumed her study after that and she completed her homeopathy course. When she was doing all these things, she was ridiculed by many. But at the end now, when she has become a doctor, those people who ridiculed her have become her patients. So she narrated this story with great pride. Immediately, we got call from this Miraj orphanage. 5-6 girls were telling us, yes, we will also take education seriously hereafter and we want to become doctors. So I think that proved to be the great source of inspiration for them. So I think it has served its purpose, I will say.
Yes, great. And we would certainly like to hear more about the segments and programs, how you are targeting. You know, there is research and then there is execution of this radio program. In 30 minutes, you are delivering 3 segments. But before we move forward, I would request Pooja to show a capsule, like Bannatshala capsule, what they are exactly doing, how they are approaching. We'll hear. Let's listen to this clip. Yes.
भाई लोग आप सुन रहे हैं अपना फेवरेट वाला रेडियो, ये है रेडियो टाइम पास। और बताओ कौन मैं।
A lot is achieved by encouraging the children to open up in radio time pass, जैसे कि correcting their thought process and bringing it on proper track।
एक बात मेरे मन में चल रही है कि मेरे माँ के बारे में जब कोई बात करता है तो मुझे बुरा लगता है।
हाँ।
दूसरे के माँ के बारे में जब मैं बात करता हूँ उसको माँ बहन पे गाली कैसे दे सकता हूँ।
कितनी सही बात बोल रहा है ये बंदा यार।
इंट्रोस्पेक्शन थ्रू ओपन डिस्कशंस ऑन सेंसिटिव टॉपिक्स।
चला तर मग आपण आपल्या मित्रांकडून ऐकूया की मर्द म्हणजे काय। मुकेश भाई बताओ जरा।
मर्द म्हणजे जे आई वडिलांना बायकोला मुलांना जे सांभाळते त्यांना खरं मर्द म्हणते। जे काम करते सगळं परिवार सांभाळते त्यांनाच मर्द। जर आपण कोणाने मारपीट केली त्यांनी मर्द नाही म्हणत।
उनको अपने दुख दर्द एक्सप्रेस करने को मदद करना एंड सजेस्टिंग सोल्यूशन्स फॉर देम।
इथे आल्यावर तुझ्यात काय फरक पडला, काय वाटतं तुला?
चूक केलं हे तर जाणवतंय, अशी चूक कोणीच करायला नाही पाहिजे। उलट त्यांचं घरचं चांगलं ना, त्यांनी घरच्यांना एकदा तरी बोलावं की आपल्या मनात काय आहे असं निर्णय नाही घ्यायला पाहिजे। लगेच पळून जायचा, बोलायचं की मी चुकलो।
लास्ट बट नॉट द लिस्ट, रिइन्स्टेटिंग इम्पॉर्टन्स ऑफ फॅमिली and relations like mother and sister.
मला माहिती आहे माझ्या आईनी मला किती कष्ट करून मोठं केले आहे ते। मी जेव्हा 5 वर्षाचा असणार माझ्या वडिलांनी मी माझ्या आईला लई मारलं होतं। आणखीन म्हणलं होतं की तू आत्ताच्या आता घरातून निघून जा। आणखी माझी आई आणखीन आम्ही 3 भाऊ घराच्या बाहेर चालले गेलो। त्या दिवशी फक्त माझ्या आईकडे 5 रुपये होते। आणखीन ते पण माझ्यासाठी फक्त पार्ले बिस्किट घेऊन देत होती। आणखीन ते पार्ले बिस्किट चारून मला ते रात्र तिथंच काढले। त्याच्यानंतर आजपर्यंत मला मोठी गेली लई गाई गाई गेली।
आईनं पण मला पहिले पण भरपूर सांगितलं होतं की चुका वगैरे काही करू नको, पण मी ते आईचं ऐकलं नव्हतं। ते सॉरी म्हणायचं आईला, परत नाही करणार ती गोष्ट।
कुठेतरी आई ऐकते खरं।
सॉरी आई, मी परत कधी असं काही करणार नाही। ते चूक केली मी ती परत कधीच नाही करणार।
Initially, Bannatshala connected hundreds of juvenile offenders from 53 remand homes in Maharashtra. और उनकी सोच में बदलाव लाने में कुछ हद तक कामयाब भी रही। This pilot project has proved the immense potential of this participatory web radio channel. और अब इसको upscale करना और भी आगे ले जाना बहुत आवश्यक है, क्योंकि औरत के बारे में हर किसी की सोच बदलना जरूरी है। फॉर विच वी हैव टू कैच देम यंग। देयरफॉर इट इज प्रपोज्ड टू रीच मिलियंस ऑफ चिल्ड्रन फ्रॉम ओवर 1 lakh स्कूल्स इन महाराष्ट्र। दे विल हैव टू बी अप्रोच्ड फॉर जॉइनिंग इन दिस वंडरफुल एंड मोस्ट एसेंशियल इनिशिएटिव। थैंक यू।
Yes, that was great presentation. Dr. Zoghe, you have written a book some time back, but it speaks about students who could not succeed, you know, in typical way, and what they can achieve in their life. And you have segmented your program based on your research. It is not only about you are giving some gyan to all these dropouts or students from rural area. So can you tell us more about these 3 segments in your program?
Yeah, that segment, first I will talk about that segment. Napa Sanchi Shala means school for backbenchers or failed students. That book was published by Penguin India in 2006. All the children, even if they are not murder, criminals or offenders, they too could relate to that segment very much. Because why children fail? It is not their mistake. It's the mistake of school, education system and all this, and how they can succeed in their lives. So it was like showing a mirror to them. You are not lacking anything. You too can be successful in your life. So that was also very well received by children. Then earlier I have mentioned the रेडिओ टाइमपास अँड अनदर वन वॉज गप्पा टप्पा मीन्स डिस्कशन काउन्सेलिंग इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट इम्पॉर्टंट टॉपिक्स करियर काउन्सेलिंग ऑल दिस थिंग्स सो थ्री सेगमेंट्स वी आर देअर आय कॅन टॉक अ लॉट अबाउट इट बट बिकॉज ऑफ टाइम
Yes, time restrictions are there. And I have one last question to ask. I don't know Professor Bipin could join us or not, but you can tell us more about...
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, sir.
Welcome, Bipin.
Welcome, sir.
I could join with audio, still my video is not...
Not an issue. You are running a radio.
Yes.
Great. Technology is not our slave. We are slaves of technology.
Yes. So, Professor Sogule, I am sure, you could tell us more about what next. You want to catch them young, you want to expand your radio program, but Cyrus Poonawalla's donation is not enough. You need more hands.
Yes.
So
the thing is, potential culprits or potential victims are our audiences, or our, beneficiaries. And they are not confined to a state or a language. They are
even urban and rural areas. They are
everywhere. Poor, rich, nothing, no class, no creed, no barrier. So we want to reach to every child between the age of 12 to 19 years and to impart this information and also understand their views, their points, especially about poverty, about sexuality, and about so many things, drugs. They are so intertwined with each other, all these criminal fields, that we want to let children understand that this is not the way we should go. What problems we have need to be tackled in a different way. And we need to reach out of Maharashtra, starting with Hindi belt, then starting with other languages, and for which we need a proper setup. Now this is Bannad Shala is a pilot project. It is run on a very pilot mode. Minimal manpower, minimal funds and everything. Even people who are paid are only paid token remuneration. These are not proper professional remuneration. So we want to make it big, really take it to every corner of India, if possible, even abroad. If people want to copy it, we are ready to share our know-how and make people do things. Ours is not a commercial motive. But we are not an NGO. MB Creations is my institution, which is a production house. We make programs, mostly we are into television and films. We have made a film on a rape victim, which with funding from Cyrus Poonawalla sir, and that's how all these things started. But we want to keep it non-commercial, but still we need funds. So for which we want people to come ahead and take us everywhere. Also, we want government agencies to participate. In Maharashtra, we could convince the Commissioner of Women and Child Welfare. They agreed, and that's how we reached the observation homes. And then we convinced corporations like Pune Corporation and then Village Social Transformation Foundation. And that's how we reached to thousands and then really, really lakhs of children. Similar things we want to do in other states. And we want to initiate people and activists like us to start these activities in their own languages. This is how we want to go ahead.
Yes. Professor Sogule, could you tell us more about how many community radios and other partners have associated with this radio program?
In Maharashtra, we have approached 23 community radio stations and two educational web radio channels who have agreed and they have been relaying our programs on regular basis, and we have kind of reached their audiences, which are really, really in lakhs. We have reached around 45 lakh of total population, out of which at least we think 5 lakh are children between this age group. And we are getting good responses from them. And this really, really encouraging and heartening. And it tells us that we are on the right track.
Okay. So this is the radio program which you want to convert into by children, for children, radio.
Yes. Program. The thing is, now we are handling it. We are mainly, maneuvering and doing everything. But we want more and more children or young adults to take in charge of this and handle it the way they want it. And also eventually, we want to convert this into a regular television channel, free for children, by the children.
For the children, because establishing horizontal communication between sender and receiver, that will be the most effective one, that's what we feel. And that will be first of its kind in India. This is our dream.
Yes. And basically, peer-to-peer communication is far stronger than top-down communication. We often tend to misunderstand how to communicate with children. We have been working with children for many, many years. So we understand that sometimes we lack talking to them. We lack the empathy. We lack the know-how to understand the inner cores of their mind, which they can do with each other. So we want to enhance and we want to promote that.
Great. Thank you very much, Professor Chaugule and Dr. Vedmanti Jogi. I wish you speedy recovery, Chaugule sir. And now I hand over this program mic to Malti.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. What a truly touching and wonderful initiative. Banat Shala. Thanks, Dr. Vedavati, Vipin Chaugule. Thanks, Alka, for that riveting conversation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So now, friends, let's take a short break from the conversations and watch a short film, Temple, which highlights the irony of our society where men pray to women deities but ask for a boon of getting a boy.
आज तक हर मन्नत पूरी की है आपने, जो मांगा चोली में डाला है। अब मैं बाप बनने जा रहा हूं और आपके दर पे आया हूं। एक ही आस है मुझे, बेटी मत देना मां।
एक मां से ही बेटी ना देने की मांग, ये कैसा दोगलापन? इसके विरुद्ध शपथ लें, लाडली.org पर लॉग ऑन करें।
Let's move on to the final segment of today's event. We all know that there is a flip side to our increasing digital engagement, and that is increasing cyberbullying, harassment, and abuse. We have with us Dr. Sherlyn Pimenta and Dipti Panesar of Kathanika, presenting the perils of the digital world through one of the most ancient means of communication, puppets. They believe that stories help the mind to be receptive to ideas and thoughts. The Kathanika team uses stories and designs to educate, inform, and sensitize people of all ages on various issues. Over to you, Dipti and Sherlyn.
Thank you, Malti, for that lovely welcome. We are happy to be here. And let me share the film that we've put together for all of you. Dipti, can you see the screen?
Yes, I can see the screen.
All right.
There's no sound.
Yes, just a minute. It will start.
दूर एक गांव में रहती है एक लड़की जिसका नाम है पीहू। पीहू सिर्फ 8 साल की, लेकिन वह बहुत ही समझदार और सुलझी हुई लड़की है। उसके बहुत सारे दोस्त हैं और उसे नए दोस्त बनाना बहुत पसंद है। लेकिन आज पता है उसका सबसे प्रिय दोस्त कौन है? उसकी मम्मी का फोन। तो कैसे बना मम्मी का फोन पीहू का बेस्ट फ्रेंड? यह उसी की दिलचस्प कहानी है। पीहू गंगापुर गांव में अपनी माँ के साथ रहती है। वो वहां स्कूल भी जाती और शाम को स्कूल खत्म होने पर अपने दोस्तों के साथ मैदान पर खूब खेलती और दौड़ती। बड़ा मजा आता। पर अचानक एक दिन कोविड का कहर देश पर आया। स्कूल सब बंद है। यहाँ तक कि घर से बाहर निकलने पर भी पाबंदी होती है। समय काटने के लिए पीहू पूरा दिन कभी मम्मी के घर के कामों में मदद करती तो कभी किताबें पढ़ती, कभी चित्रकारी करती तो कभी अकेले ही नोटी खेलती। कोविड के लॉकडाउन में दिन हफ्तों में और हफ्ते महीनों में बदले। पीहू घर बैठे ना ही दोस्तों को घर पर बुला सकती थी और ना ही स्कूल के मैदान पर दौड़ सकती थी। हर दिन बहुत उदास और मायूस लगता था। फिर एक दिन उसकी मम्मी को स्कूल की टीचर से फोन आया। हेलो टीचर जी, नमस्ते, बताइए कैसे फोन करना हुआ?
नमस्ते बहन जी, लॉकडाउन के चलते पाठशाला में बच्चे तो आ नहीं पा रहे हैं, तो इसलिए अब हम पाठशाला को ही बच्चों के पास लेकर जा रहे हैं। कल से पीयू की पढ़ाई हम फोन पर ही शुरू करेंगे, बाकी बच्चे भी अब ऐसे ही पढ़ेंगे। आप अपना फोन रोज 3 घंटे के लिए पीयू को दे दें।
पीहू को ये बात जैसे ही पता चली तो वो खुशी से उछल पड़ी। अरे वाह, माँ का फोन अब बिना डांट खाए इस्तेमाल कर पाऊंगी, ये। अब पीहू का स्कूल रोज 3 घंटे के लिए फोन पर चल रहा है। टीचर फोन पर सिखाती और उनकी बातें सुन सुनकर पीहू अपनी नोटबुक पर लिखती। स्कूल के सारे बच्चों ने मिलकर एक व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप, वहां पर सब गपशप करते, स्कूल की और गांव की। पीहू को गप्पे लड़ाने में बड़ा मजा आता। पीहू को पता था कि फोन का स्कूल के कामों के अलावा दूसरे भी उपयोग थे। वह इंटरनेट के जरिए सिर्फ अपने गांव की ही नहीं बल्कि पूरी दुनिया की खबर रख सकती थी। अपने फोन के जरिए वो दुनिया खोज भी सकती थी और घूम भी सकती। सारा दिन पीहू फोन पर लगी रही, कभी पिक्चर देखती तो कभी गाने सुनती और कभी कभी खबरें भी पढ़ती। तो इस तरह फोन उसका सबसे नया और महत्वपूर्ण यंत्र बन गया। पीहू को धीरे धीरे पता चल गया कि अगर वो फोन पर प्लस साइन के साथ कोई भी 10 या 12 अंक जोड़ दे तो वह विश्व के किसी कोने का फोन नंबर बन जाता। एक फोन कॉल के तो पैसे लगते थे, पर व्हाट्सएप पे कॉल मुफ्त था। व्हाट्सएप के जरिए वो दुनिया में किसी के साथ भी जुड़ सकता। तो पीयू ने व्हाट्सएप से नए दोस्त बनाने की निष्ठा बनाई। पीयू रोज नए नए नंबर बनाते और उनको हाय या हेलो का संदेश भेजते। कभी कभार सामने से जवाब आता पर ज्यादातर कोई जवाब नहीं देता। फिर एक दिन अचानक एक अनजान नंबर से पीहू को हेलो करके मैसेज आया। पीहू ने फोन नंबर पर फोटो देखा तो उसकी ही उम्र की एक सुनहरे बालों वाली लड़की की तस्वीर। पीहू का मन खुशी से उछल पड़ा। क्या ये मेरी मित्र बन सकती है? सोचते हुए पीहू ने झटपट जवाब टाइप किया। हाय, कौन हो तुम? तुम्हारा नाम क्या है? कहाँ से हो तुम?
मेरा नाम दिया है। मैं दीमकपुर में रहती हूँ। तुम कहाँ रहती हो?
दीमकपुर? वो कहाँ है? मैं गंगापुर में रहती हूँ।
वो बहुत दूर है गंगापुर से, मीलों दूर। हम पहाड़ों में रहते हैं। तुम्हारे माता पिता क्या करते हैं?
मेरे पिताजी तो गुजर गए 2 साल पहले। मेरी माँ पहले घर पर रहती थी, अब पिताजी की दुकान चलाती है।
ओह, कितनी दुख की बात है। मेरे भी पिताजी नहीं है। तुम्हारे पिताजी की दुकान का क्या नाम है?
सुमन स्टोर। पिताजी माँ को बहुत प्यार करते थे, इसीलिए उन्होंने अपनी दुकान का नाम उनके नाम पर रखा था। मेरे पिताजी का नाम श्याम था।
क्या तुम्हें अपने पिताजी की याद आती है?
हाँ,
कभी कभी कुछ खास यादें तो नहीं है क्योंकि मैं बहुत छोटी थी ना जब वो गुजर गए, पर मुझे आज भी याद है कि वो मुझे मेले ले जाते थे और आइसक्रीम खिलाते थे। पता है पीहू, मेरे पिताजी भी नहीं है, बहुत मिस करती हूँ। वो भी मुझे घुमाने लेकर जाते थे और कभी कभी मेरे साथ खेलते भी थे, बहुत प्यार करते थे मुझे। अच्छा, क्या तुम्हारी मम्मी तुमसे प्यार नहीं करती? करती है, लेकिन बहुत सख्त है। मैं उनकी अनुमति के बगैर कुछ करूं तो खूब डांट पड़ती है। क्या तुम्हारी मम्मी भी सख्त है?
नहीं, मेरी मम्मी मुझसे बहुत प्यार करती है, लेकिन जब उनको गुस्सा आता है ना कभी कभी, तो फिर मुझे भी बहुत डांट पड़ती है।
ओ, पर तुम्हारी मम्मी कितनी अच्छी है। मेरी मम्मी डांटती ही रहती है, मुझे कुछ नहीं करने देती। अच्छा पीहू, मुझे ना जाना होगा, कल फिर बात करेंगे।
ठीक है, बाय दिया।
गुड नाइट पीहू।
गुड नाइट। वाह दिया को तो बहुत अच्छी इंग्लिश आती है। अगर मैं दिया के साथ रोज बात करूंगी तो मेरी इंग्लिश भी बहुत अच्छी हो जाएगी।
तो इस तरह स्कूल के पश्चात पीहू दिया के साथ व्हाट्सएप पर चैट करती, कभी किताबों की बातें करते तो कभी कार्टून और कभी उनके चहेते फिल्म स्टार टाइगर श्रॉफ की। कुछ ही हफ्तों में पीहू को ऐसे लगने लगा कि जैसे दिया उसकी सबसे अच्छी सहेली बन जाए। वो उसके साथ बात करने के लिए इंतजार करती। उसने अपने गांव की दूसरी सहेलियों के साथ बात करना बहुत कम कर दिया। स्कूल के व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप पर भी वो ज्यादा चैट नहीं करती। उसे बस इंतजार रहता कि कब दिया आए और उसे मैसेज करे और वो उसके साथ फिर घंटों चैटिंग करे। एक दिन बातों बातों में दोनों अपने पसंदीदा खेल के बारे में बातचीत करने लगे।
जब लॉकडाउन नहीं था तब तुम कौन कौन से खेल खेला करती थी अपनी सहेलियों के साथ?
हम खूब सारे अलग अलग खेल खेला करते थे। कभी पिट्ठू तो कभी खो खो, पकड़ा पकड़ी, और हाँ मेरा सबसे पसंदीदा खेल चोर पुलिस।
चोर पुलिस? हाँ, वो तो मुझे भी बहुत पसंद है, बड़ा मजा आता है। मैं ऐसी जगह छुपती थी कि मेरे दोस्त मुझे घंटों ढूंढते रह जाते थे पर मैं मिलती ही नहीं थी।
अच्छा, अरे वाह, कहाँ छुपती थी तुम?
मैं छुपने वाली जगहों को पहचानने में बड़ी माहिर हूँ। बताऊंगी तुम्हें कभी कि कैसे छुपा जाता है। खैर छोड़ो, इसके अलावा हम यहाँ पर पहाड़ों में साइकिलिंग जाते हैं और तैरने भी जाते हैं। क्या तुम्हें तैरना आता है?
हाँ हाँ आता है। हमारे गांव से एक नहर जाती है, हम बच्चे गर्मियों में वहाँ पर खूब तैरते हैं। तुम तो पहाड़ों में रहती हो, पहाड़ों में पानी होता है क्या?
कितनी भोली हो तुम भी। हाँ भाई, सारी नदियाँ तो पहाड़ों से ही शुरू होती हैं। मैं नदी में ही तैरती हूँ। तुम क्या पहनकर तैरती हो?
मैं सलवार कमीज पहनकर तैरती हूँ।
सलवार कमीज?
हंसने की क्या बात है?
सलवार कमीज, ये थोड़ी ना कोई पहनकर तैरने वाली चीज है। तैरने के खास कपड़े होते हैं, उन्हें स्विमिंग कॉस्ट्यूम कहा जाता है। हमारे गांव में सब वही पहन कर तैरते हैं।
अच्छा, मुझे तो नहीं पता था। कैसे दिखते हैं ये स्विमिंग कॉस्ट्यूम? गांव में तो किसी के पास नहीं है।
नहीं नहीं, तुम्हारे गांव में सबके पास है, बस किसी को पता नहीं है कि सिर्फ उसी को पहन कर तैरा जाता है, ना कि सलवार कमीज पहनकर।
मतलब
गांव में सब चड्डी पहनते हैं ना?
हाँ।
तो उसी को तो स्विमिंग कॉस्ट्यूम बोलते हैं। तुमने कभी सिर्फ चड्डी पहनकर तैरने की कोशिश करी है? पता है मछली के जैसे तेज हो जाते हैं हम। हाँ, अगली बार कोशिश करना, तुम्हें एहसास होगा कि तुम बहुत तेजी से तैर पा रही हो।
लेकिन उसके लिए तुम्हें प्रैक्टिस करनी पड़ेगी।
अच्छा, लेकिन फिलहाल तो मैं नहीं कर सकती, कोविड की वजह से सब कुछ बंद है, बाहर भी नहीं जा सकती।
अरे कोई नहीं, मैं हूँ ना, मैं तुम्हारी घर पर ही प्रैक्टिस करा दूँ। जब लॉकडाउन खुलेगा ना, तब फिर तुम गांव की सबसे तेज लड़की हो जाओ।
अच्छा, तो मुझे क्या करना होगा?
सबसे पहले तुम मुझे चड्डी पहनकर एक फोटो भेजो, फिर मैं तुम्हें बताती हूँ कि कैसे तैरना है।
ठीक है, तुम किसी को बताओगे तो नहीं ना, सब मुझे तकनी लड़की बुलाएगी।
नहीं नहीं, कोई नहीं हंसेगा, मैं किसी को नहीं बताऊँ।
पीहू सोच में पड़ गई, क्या ये सही है?
सही ही होगा, क्योंकि दिया मेरी दोस्त है, वो मेरा बुरा क्यों चाहेगी?
पीहू ने अपनी चड्डी पहनी हुई तस्वीर खींचकर दिया को व्हाट्सएप कर दिया।
चलो अब वीडियो चैटिंग करते हैं।
ठीक है।
ओह, तुम बहुत खूबसूरत हो, बहुत बहुत ज्यादा सुंदर भी। अब ऐसा करो, मुझे ना बिना चड्डी पहने हुए भी एक तस्वीर भेजो, मैं देखना चाहती हूँ कि तुम कैसी दिखती हो।
दिया, ऐसे कैसी बात कर रही हो तुम? नहीं, मैं तुम्हें बिना कपड़ों वाली तस्वीर नहीं भेजूंगी।
तुम भेजोगी और अभी भेजोगी, क्योंकि अगर तुमने नहीं भेजी तो फिर मैं तुम्हारी माँ को बता दूंगी कि तुम कितनी गंदी लड़की हो। मैं तुम्हारी ये चड्डी वाली फोटो पूरे गंगापुर में लगा दूंगी।
नहीं नहीं।
हाँ,
लेकिन क्यों? तुमने तो कहा था कि तुम किसी को नहीं बताओगी।
मैंने झूठ कहा था। और मैं तुम्हें एक और बात बताऊं, मैं दिया नहीं, दानव हूँ। और अब से तुम्हें जैसा बोला जा रहा है तुम्हें वैसा ही करना होगा। अगर तूने नहीं किया तो मैं तुम्हारी फोटो की पोस्टर बना के तुम्हारे पूरे गंगापुर में लगा दूंगा। सबको पता चल जाएगा कि तुम कितनी गंदी लड़की हो। पीहू
रोते हुए, क्यों रो रही हो पीहू, क्या हो गया?
मैंने अपनी एक फोटो दिया को भेज दी, जो असल में दानव था। दानव ने मुझे धमकी दी है कि अगर मैं उसे और गंदी गंदी फोटो नहीं भेजूंगी तो फिर वो गांव में सबको मेरी फोटो दिखा देगा और माँ और मेरी बहुत ज्यादा शर्मिंदगी होगी। मुझे समझ में नहीं आ रहा कि मैं क्या करूं।
फिक्र मत करो पीहू, मैं तुम्हारी मदद कर सकता हूँ। चलो 10, 9, 8 पर फोन लगाते हैं, वह दानव को अच्छा सबक सिखाएंगे।
या 10, 9, 8 क्या होता है?
जो बच्चे तकलीफ में होते हैं उनकी मदद के लिए 10, 9, 8 नंबर बनाया गया है। अगर कोई बच्चा किसी भी तरह की संकट या दुविधा में है तो इस नंबर पर फोन करना चाहिए, कोई ना कोई उनकी तुरंत मदद करेगा।
तो चलो 10, 9, 8 डायल करें।
हेलो फोन, क्या बात है? तुमने हमें कैसे याद किया?
हमारी पीयू संकट में है, उसे दानव नाम का एक प्राणी बहुत परेशान कर रहा है, उसे गंदी गंदी फोटोज मांग रहा है।
अच्छा, ऐसी बात है। तो उसका पता बताओ, हम उसकी अभी खबर
लें। उसका पूरा पता तो नहीं है हमारे पास, लेकिन हमारे पास उनका फोन नंबर है। वह दीमकपुर में रहता है और दिया नाम की लड़की का झूठा नाम देकर बच्चों को परेशान कर रहा है।
ठीक है, उसका नंबर बताओ, हम
उसको। मैं अभी उसका नंबर आपको भेजता हूँ। 10, 9, 8 पुलिस को सूचित करते हैं। पुलिस दांड को ढूंढ लेती है और गिरफ्तार कर जेल में डाल देती है। जब ये बात पता चलती है तो वो खुशी से नाचने लगते हैं।
शुक्रिया फोन, आपने मेरी बहुत मदद की, वरना मुझे तो समझ में ही नहीं आ रहा था कि मैं क्या करूं।
नो प्रॉब्लम पीहू, ये तो मेरा कर्तव्य है, मैं बना ही हूँ तुम्हारी मदद करने के लिए, लेकिन तुम्हें भी बहुत सतर्क होकर मेरा इस्तेमाल करना चाहिए। मैं केवल एक यंत्र हूँ, एक साधन हूँ तुम्हारी सहायता के लिए। यह तुम्हारा जिम्मा है, तुम मेरा सदुपयोग करोगी या दुरुपयोग, इसलिए तुम्हें मेरा इस्तेमाल बहुत ही सावधानी से करना चाहिए।
मुझे किन बातों से सतर्क रहना चाहिए?
किसी भी फोन या कंप्यूटर से इंटरनेट का इस्तेमाल करने के समय कुछ चीजों का आगे से ध्यान रखना। एक, किसी भी अजनबी से बात मत करना या मैसेज करना। दो, अगर इंटरनेट पर किसी अजनबी को दोस्त बनाना है तो माता पिता या भाई बहन की आज्ञा लें और उस व्यक्ति का प्रोफाइल अवश्य जांच कराएं। तीन, किसी भी प्रकार की व्यक्तिगत जानकारी किसी को भी ना बताना, जैसे तुम्हारा नाम, सही पता, तुम्हारे माता पिता का नाम, उनका व्यापार, बैंक खाते की जानकारी, तुम्हारे पास कितने पैसे हैं, कोई फोटो इत्यादि। चार, अगर कोई चड्डी वाली फोटो, कम कपड़ों वाली फोटो या बिना कपड़े वाली फोटो मांगे तो साफ इनकार कर देना चाहिए और तुरंत अपने माता पिता को बता देना। उन्हें तब तक बताते रहना जब तक वो तुम्हारी बात अच्छी तरह से सुन ना ले, या फिर 10-9-8 पर फोन करना। पांच, और सबसे जरूरी बात, अगर तुमसे कोई जबरदस्ती करने की कोशिश करे या तुम्हें डराए धमकाए तो तुम्हें जोर से और साफ अक्षरों में ना करना चाहिए और तुरंत अपने माता पिता या 10-9-8 को सूचित करना चाहिए। देखो भी, इंटरनेट की दुनिया बाहर की दुनिया जैसी ही है, यहाँ पर अच्छे लोग भी हैं और बहुत बुरे लोग भी हैं। अगर तुम इंटरनेट का इस्तेमाल सावधानी और सतर्कता से करोगी तो तुम्हें सबसे ज्यादा फायदा होगा, क्योंकि एक इंटरनेट ही है जो तुम्हें घर बैठे बैठे पूरी दुनिया घुमा सकती है।
धन्यवाद फोन, मैं ये सब बातों का आगे से ध्यान रखूंगी।
और फिर उस दिन से पीहू ने अनजान लोगों से व्हाट्सएप पर चैट करना बंद कर दिया और अपनी सहेलियों के साथ दोबारा बातचीत शुरू कर दी, और इसी तरह पीहू का सबसे अच्छा दोस्त बन गया उसकी मम्मी का फोन। वह दोनों अब गंगापुर में अपने गांव में एकदम खुश खुश रहते हैं और दानव जेल में बहुत दुखी दुखी रहता है। दानव तो अब जेल में है पीहू, हम दोनों अब पार्टी करते हैं।
हाँ हाँ, बहुत अच्छा आइडिया है।
तो पीहू, क्या तुम्हें मैं एक गाना सुनाऊं?
हाँ सुनाओ फोन, सुनाओ।
लेकिन मुझे वो गाने के लिए तुम्हारी मदद लगेगी। बच्चों, क्या तुम सब भी मेरी मदद करोगे?
हाँ हाँ।
तो जब मैं गाना शुरू करूंगा, हर लाइन के बाद तुम सब बोलोगे कभी नहीं, समझे?
ठीक है।
जैसे चड्डी में फोटो,
कभी नहीं।
बिल्कुल ठीक, तो चलो गाना शुरू करते। 1, 2, 3, 4। चड्डी में फोटो,
कभी नहीं।
कभी नहीं।
कपड़ों की फोटो,
कभी नहीं।
इंटरनेट पे भेजो,
कभी नहीं।
क्या डरू मैं इनसे,
कभी नहीं।
कोई छू ले मुझको,
कभी नहीं।
तो मैं चुप्पी साधु,
कभी नहीं।
मम्मी से छुपाऊं,
कभी नहीं।
कभी नहीं, कभी नहीं, कभी नहीं, कभी नहीं। जो करे कोई परेशान हमें, 10-9-8 पर रिपोर्ट करे उन्हें। बाय बच्चों, अपना ख्याल रखना।
बाय
बाय।
We hope you enjoyed the film.
Yes, we did.
So we hope the message goes to the children, and we put it in a way where we felt that the children could relate to the characters, and they take the message. And because today the internet is everywhere, small kids are using the internet. So this is what we had.
I mean, we felt that children today, we cannot stop the children from using the internet and being exposed to information. I mean, eventually they are going to be there. So instead of censoring it for them, if you know they're made aware of it, then they can be strong enough to make, you know, the choice between what is good and what is bad for them. I mean, that's the best way we can give them protection, by making them more, you know, enabling their own intellect in judgment. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Could you show us Dhanav?
Here's Dhanav. So that's
Pihu,
and that's, Dia, and this is Dhanav. So, I mean, he is a split personality. He has a pseudo profile, which he uses online, and this is what his true face is. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Katanika team, for this brilliant puppet show. It was truly brilliant. It's so important, you know, today for our young generation to be aware of such advantages as well as the disadvantages that we have on internet. We saw how Dhanav can strike us in a garb of a friend and how he stepped in to help. So remember, children, to reach out to your parents, use the helpline to report. Take care, be safe. I now take your leave and invite Swati Chaganti to propose a formal vote of thanks.
I think Swati is not able to do, there's some problem with her connection, so I'll take over and propose the vote of thanks. So this has been a great afternoon with some really great conversations and thought-provoking ideas and videos and performances. So special thanks to all of you and our guest, Ms. Indu Harikumar, Bipin Chandra Chaugle, Dr. Vedavati Zogi, or Bhanat Shala, and especially the children of Nimble Q, young Archita, Sheel, Garvit, and Dr. Sherline Pimenta and Dipti Panesar of Kathanika and Folklore Arts. Thank you, Alka Dhukkar Gargi, for steering this great conversation. And thank you, Malti, for steering us through this entire thread. I would like to express a gratitude to our guests of honor, Mr. Sriram Haridass, representative acting in charge at UNFPA, and Ms. Marit M. Strand, counselor and head of cooperation at the Norwegian Embassy in New Delhi. This event would not have been possible without the support of UNFPA and the Royal Norwegian Embassy. So a special thank you to Ms. Anuja Gulati and team UNFPA, as also the Royal Norwegian Embassy in New Delhi. Last but not the least, I would like to thank Dr. A.L. Sharda, Director of Population First, and the team of Population First, Malati Kembavi, Pooja Nagdev, Swati Chaganti, for bringing together yet another delightful event marking the International Day of the Girl Child. I hope, as a fellow team member at Population First, we continue to present some of the most wonderful events and interventions and promote the cause of the girl child. I wish you all a good evening. Stay safe, take care, and thank you for joining us. See you until the next time. Bye-bye. Pooja, could you play that last Ladli song so that we go with that memory of empowering our girl child? Thank you.
चंचले खिल भी कली ये नखट ये चंचले सबसे भली ये छोटी सी